Snoo Math is whipping motherfuckers ass. You wanna know how to rhyme, you better learn how to add. It's mathematics.
Mighty most deaf.
It's simple mathematics. Check it out. I revolve around science.
What are we talking about here?
Peace, peace, peace. Welcome to another episode of Wise the Dome. Today I have a very, very special guest, man. He's one of the dopest MCs, lyricists in the game. JR, I appreciate you for coming through.
Peace, man. Glad to be here, man.
No doubt, no doubt, man. Well, congrats on the album, Hoop Dreams 2, the EP. It's an extremely dope project, man. Been in constant rotation. Produced by Nicholas Craven, got Ty Ferris and Ransom on there, and just an extremely dope project, man. For those who haven't heard the project yet, man, what can they expect when they listen to this one?
Oh, man. I feel like it's one of my favorite projects that I've made, like, personally. It was one of my favorites. Also got, you know, production from my guy Ayo Shamir for two tracks. Had fun creating it. I was trying to, you know, tell a little story. Mm-hmm. Had Errol Manigo on the cover, man. A lot of guys, everybody's, you know, journey with the hoop stuff. You know, that's my first love. So everybody's journey with that joint was different. It's different. Mm-hmm. And I just trying to make something that hoopers and, you know, people who don't hoop can relate to.
Right. And yeah, that's extremely dope. Even like the names of the joints, like Give and Go, you know, with Ransom. Man, y'all went bar for bar, man. Y'all was going crazy on that joint, man. You know, just tell me about that one, man, because that was crazy.
Oh yeah, Ram, man, that's for people who don't know him. I mean, he's one of the best lyricists we have, man. So I already knew, like, I was gonna have to, you know, step anytime I get on the track with Ram, I gotta come with it or whatever. Mm-hmm. So when we decided to do that back and forth, I'm like, yo, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I know I gotta set the tone or whatever, but I know he gonna mm-hmm. come just as hard every time. Like it was really refreshing, man. Like, cause the way we did it, like we in two different states, so mm-hmm. We were sending the track back and forth to each other and just knocking it out like that. Every time he sent me something back, I was like, man, it's just, dude, yeah, he's crazy, man. It's pretty fun.
Yeah, man. I could tell, man. You had a good time making it. For people that don't necessarily understand the basketball references, like, basketball was your first love, right?
Yeah.
What's so as far as you hooped in college, right?
I did 1 year at a small Christian school in Wisconsin, and that was really, I just did that 1 year. Honestly, I just wanted the experience, mm-hmm. the college experience. So I did it. After that, I chilled for a couple of years, and then I ended up getting an opportunity to play overseas. Mm-hmm. I did that before I got injured.
No, where were you at?
I was in France.
Oh, wow, man. How was that experience?
It was dope, man. It was a lot. It was a lot more, like, easier to get adjusted to the lifestyle over there than I expected. Mm-hmm. I did take a little French in high school, so I kind of retained a little bit of that, mm-hmm. and it was coming back to me more as I was, the longer I was over there. But everybody, you know, they treated us like royalty, basically, man, and most of the areas we were in. So, I didn't really expect that, you know, being American, you know, they, a lot of other countries feel like we spoiled and all that. And I mean, for the most part, I did it. But they welcomed me like I was one of their own. So it was a dope experience.
Yeah, that's good, man. That's dope. You know, it just adds to the story. whenever you like, how does like the competitive spirit of basketball like translate in the booth?
So I've always been I like to I push myself most of the time, but I use things to for motivation. Like I use, like, you know, when I was in high school, I didn't get to play. I tried it. When a coach begged me to try out, I tried out. He cut me the whole school talking about it. Like, it was like how he cut James, whatever. He called me back to the team. I go. So I'm in the practice. I'm like chipping my shoulder because I got cut in the first place over, yeah, you know, some guys that weren't as good. And I, you know, just going crazy in practice. So I'm thinking like I'm about to be starting or whatever. Get to the game. We had the first game. I didn't see any minutes. Sat the bench the whole game, watched, like, and I'm watching him putting guys in the game that, you know, weren't good. Like, I'm like, all right, bro, I'm not gonna do this for a whole season. So I just, you know, I quit. I left the team or whatever. But that kind of, I don't know, it like kind of put something in me, man. Cause at first I was kind of down about it. So I kind of felt like I wasn't good enough for a while. And then it just turned into like fuel to be better, like to get better. So I never stopped thinking that I could get better. Like I still feel like I can get better now. And I mean, that was years ago. Nice. So it's always stuck with me. And it's the same with music. Like when I just feel I rap with a chip on my shoulder, man. Like just feeling like you know, I'm being overlooked a lot and stuff like that, or left out of certain conversations, which I don't really care to be in those, but when I see it, it's like, okay, cool. Like, bet.
Yeah, that's kind of leads to what I wanted to ask you. You know, as somebody who, like, top tier lyricist, right? I mean, everybody that listens to your music always, you know, comes back with a similar idea about your skills as far as, you know, how dope your bars are.
Right.
Do you think that, you know, in today's game right now, like, the lyricist is not getting the light, the lyricists aren't getting the light that they should be? Because, you know, like, we even saw the whole thing with Flex and Conway the other day, right? Where, you know, the premise seems to me that they were arguing over was, you know, Griselda not making, you know, I guess party records or club records or radio records. But that goes to, you know, everything. You know, there was a time when a radio record wasn't necessarily a party record, you know what I'm saying? Or a record that got pushed wasn't it, like, we can look at, you know, Brenda's Got a Baby, Renee Lost Boys, you know, like, these are party records. These are records that are, you know, talking about some, or Cannabis, you know, whenever he was coming out with just straight pure lyricism, those songs was on the radio. Like, what, as far as the game is now, you know, like, being a lyricist, you know, like, where, like, do you ever feel like, you know, y'all not getting the light that y'all should be?
I feel like for some, maybe, but, you know, it's when I think about it and I see how that stuff goes, I just think it's like it's mostly about preference and popularity, honestly, man. Because I see a lot of people talk about certain rappers or whatever that they love or whatever, but then I hear rappers who are better, and I'm like, so they ain't talking about them, but they love lyricism, but you're not talking about this, you know what I'm saying, this particular artist, whatever. So I feel like it's preference, man, which I can't knock it. Like, but the light, I feel like it's anybody can get it because, I mean, the looking at social media now, it's like it's not – people be going viral for all types of stuff, man. So, yeah, I think you just got to be, you know, seen by the right person at the right time. Like, that's the smallest little retweet from somebody might get you a million views and you don't expect it or whatever, man. So, yeah. I think that's how I feel about it, but I mean, personally, I don't really feel a way when it comes to it. Like, well, to with my music, like I just use it as fuel, like I said, to create and just think of better ways to approach bars or whatever. Like, this is like, you know, nobody talking in the way I'm like, nobody putting this joint together the way I am. Like, that's not
that's like, part of just having giving that me more motivation. Shoulder, huh?
Yeah, like giving me more motivation to be more creative with the ways I put my stuff together.
Yeah, word. And one thing that I saw a lot of people saying, like every time you drop, is the fact that you know, you don't waste bars, right? And anytime like with your music, you're not going to catch everything on the first listen. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You always catch something new every time you listen. With that being said, and not wasting bars and being extremely bar heavy, like, what is your writing process like? You know what I mean? Like just take us through, you know what I mean? JR writing the 16.
And to be honest, most of the 16, if it's a 16, most of them, I write probably, it probably take me 20, 30 minutes at the most. Honestly, especially like with features, when I do features, like somebody send me some, if the song is already structured or whatever, which I prefer somebody, you know, they send me their song to feature on, like they already set the tone. I just come in and, you know, compliment what they did. Most of the time, man, if I know I'm writing a 16, like I'll say, okay, that's four bars, four times.
Mm-hmm.
So I structure it that way. Like I might have some one-liners that I want to get in there. Like, I think of it at the time, and I'd be like, okay, I'm gonna put this here and I'm gonna build around it. I might build four bars around one line that I had that I know was like a hard punch or something.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just connect them along the way, and it comes out like,
man,
it comes out.
You know, that's a mathematical approach to, you know what I mean, to putting out to writing, man. That's dope. You know, 20 minutes, man, 20-30 minutes, like. That's you know, some people, you know, it don't have that ability to be able to do that. Was that something that you like always had, or just the more you wrote and the more you, you know, began to hone your craft, like it's just something that came?
Yeah, it came over time. When I first like started writing, it would take me a little while, but I think I was overthinking it then.
Mm-hmm.
When I started to just be like, you know, say, you know, whatever I think, you know, when I first started, it was probably around like 2011 when I really started like trying to rap. And I would take maybe like, it probably take me 20, 30 minutes for four bars or two bars, like just overthinking it, trying to like, yo, like, what people gonna think, so like, you know, stuff like that. But once I stopped caring about that, and I got to a point where I wanted to make the work more enjoyable, it became more free for me, just letting it flow. And like I said, you know, I might have, like, I might be out doing something, like I was grocery shopping, I might just put some in my notes, put a line, I might think of a line, put it in my notes.
Mm-hmm.
And then I have a song or something that that I can use that line for, I just go back to my notes. I might put it in there, in the verse that I'm writing. I just put it at the bottom, and when I can put it in there, I put it in there. So, it's different ways, man. But like I like the way I write now way more than the way I used to. Yeah. So, yeah, I don't know, man. Back then, I was just really overthinking it.
Way
too much.
I understand. It's like you in your pocket. You're comfortable now. You know what I mean? And it's like, yeah, that's a good place to be. As far as, you know, being an MC from North Carolina, you know, underrated hip hop state with, you know, MCs like, you know, Fonte and Rapsody. And I have you right up there with them, right? Word is bond. I have you right up there with them. Who was, as far
as love.
Yeah, that's real though, man. You earned that. You know what I'm saying? And but being an MC and the legacy of, you know, North Carolina MCs, like, what is, like, when you think about that, what does that mean to you?
Honestly, man, it to be held in that regard, it's love to me, because we don't really, most of our I would say the popular artists from here that we've had, they weren't known for you know, lyricism, but
yeah,
like you mentioned, Fonte, Rapsody, you know, we got Cole. I know guys, you know, personally who are dope. They from here, they rap, you know, on that same level. Like my guy Q, King James, so Group Wrecking Crew, Shane Gang, like it's a lot of dope artists from here, like Troya, Rod D, like we got so many artists, man, and they all have different sounds, but all dope, man. They're all, you know, all right. I feel like it's amazing to me, man, to be considered one of the best from this area, because it's so many that people don't know about, and that that are like up, like top tier, man, that I've heard. So for you to say that, man, that's love, man.
Yeah, man. No, that's real. And you mentioned King James, peace to him, shout out to the homie. Y'all got great music together, Weather Report. Man, talk about that, man, because y'all got great chemistry, man, on that microphone, you know what I'm saying? And y'all both be going tit for tat. It's like, I know that there's a healthy, you know, friendly competition kind of thing or whatever, but y'all definitely bring the best out of each other, man. If you can, you know, speak about, you know, making music with King James.
Yeah, that's my guy, man. He's like a brother to me, man. I met him some years back through a mutual friend who I was doing music with at the time. And we did a song at a studio in Greensboro. It was just a random on the fly type thing. And we actually, the more we, you know, talked and spoke, we actually grew up in the same neighborhood. He was just a little, I think he was a little older than me. So he was in a different circle than I was, but it was still mutual people between us. Like I knew his little brother more than I knew him back then. Yeah. I would see him, but I didn't know him. Like we didn't speak, like he was older than us. So it was, we didn't speak that much, but over the years, man, once we started working, he's just a stand up guy, man, and wants the best for me and my career as much as I want the best for him and his. Which he actually, before he started releasing music again, he was trying to just chill and just help push my stuff. I'm like, nah, bro, like you gotta too talented, man. Yeah, man. So that's when we dropped the first weather report, and then he dropped his joints, and it was like he dropped part two. Probably do a part three, man. I'm not sure yet, but more than likely we're gonna go ahead and finish it off with a trilogy.
Dope. That's good news. That you saw when y'all released it, man. Like, everybody loved it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I think it's a dope concept, man, and it's always fun working with them. So
yeah, that's what's up, man. You know, there's I don't know. Have you seen this book yet? All right.
No, I haven't.
This is called The Real of 2021. My brother Sunez Allah put this together, and on page 119, you know, he talks about JR, you know, and he says, you know, listening to JR with his, you know, various skill sets is an exciting thing to hear. He goes on to talk about, you know, peak lyricism, and the peak lyricism that you display on the Solstice EP and Broken Easel and Pregame, also Unparalleled, you know, and he talks really highly about how, you know, your work is put together. And so this is a dope book, you know, for anybody that hasn't got it, but he builds on, like, you know, the who's who of MCs, right? But right. You know, with that said, man, you know, somebody that wrote for who wrote for the Source and Double XL in the what we, you know, a lot of times call the golden era, to get that type of feedback, you know, from somebody who's, you know, wrote about, you know, anybody from Biggie to 50, you know, to get that type of feedback, you know, like, what does it mean whenever, you know, to get the respect of your peers like you have been, like, you know, as an MC?
Everything, honestly, man. You got to link me to that book. I didn't know anything about that. That's kind of crazy, man. So, you know, of course, hearing, you know, you nice and this from fans of the hip hop is cool. It's because they make us who we are or whatever as artists. But hearing it from other artists means it means a whole lot, man. Mm. And I want to say it means a lot more when it comes to skill wise. Like, mm-hmm. to me, it means a lot more because I'm not going to tell you I think you nice. If you're an artist, you know what I mean? I don't think you're nice. Like, oh, so, yeah, that's just how I am. So when I hear from other artists who are, that I think are dope, man, it's, mm-hmm. it's humbling, man.
Yeah. And not just other artists, this is coming from a journalist, you know what I mean? I think that's extremely dope look as well. And I just peep every time you drop, or you know, you're featured on somebody's music, I look at how the reaction online is, and it's different circles, you know, like but everybody seems to appreciate your craft, man. And you know, that's a testament to you and your work ethic, and you know, like we just talked about, how you are actually mathematically crafting your bars, you know what I'm saying? It's not a joke, man. And so, you know, salute to you on that. You mentioned Ransom. Y'all got a lot of tracks together. Y'all always kill it. How did that relationship begin? You know, because y'all definitely make great music together.
So, man, I've been listening to Ransom since 2004 or 2005. Before I was even rapping, like, I was a fan of his music. And back like in the 18, we was with the 18 Days, Desert Storm stuff. But I think it was around 26, actually when I was in France in 2016, I was following him on IG, and I would like make little basketball clips like I do now, just making little basketball clips, but I was using his music for a lot of the clips, and I would tag him or whatever. He ended up following me And at the time, like I wasn't doing music like seriously, but sometimes I would post some of my, snippets and stuff like that. And one day I posted one, and he DM'd me. He was like, "Yo, you dope." And he was like, he asked me what I want to get on a track with him. And in my head, I'm like, "Hell yeah!" Like, but I hit him back like, "Yeah, for sure, whatever." And it was the Broken Promises joint on his Greatest Rapper Alive album. So like I said, I was overseas. I really didn't have anywhere to record. And I found this, one of my teammates found a spot. So I wrote the verse, went and recorded it, sent it to him. And then I had I had another joint, the Shameless joint. I had wrote a verse to that sample loop, not knowing, that he was writing one to it as well. Well, he was using it for his album, and I let him hear it, and he was like, "Yo, I'm using that same joint." He was like, "Yo, send me that." So I sent him that. So I ended up on two tracks on that album. And then the next joint he dropped was the 1%. I was on two tracks on that. So people started asking, like, "Yo, who's this dude?" Whatever. Over and then, just over time, man, like we built more and more, and he started momentum. He came out with the Director's Cut series, and was building a lot of like traction, like new traction or whatever. And he just told me, he was like, "Yeah, man, we gotta make a push." So we just been, yeah, man, we just been going. He been going crazy, man, but I just been trying to keep up.
Yeah, man, you do a great job keeping up, bro.
Appreciate it, man.
Well, I ask all the MCs that come on the same question. To you, what makes just from your standpoint, what makes an MC dope and what makes an MC trash?
Personally, I feel like anybody who ain't afraid to be themselves, even if you're not very skilled, if you being you, I that's dope to me.
Yeah.
You can't be completely garbage and being yourself is cool. Like, what I'm saying? So, you gotta have some kind of, something to keep the attention of other people, of course, but yeah, man, you being yourself, man, and it's, you can tell it's authentic. That's dope to me, man. Yeah. Being whack. Most of the time, it's not even the music side. It's usually how the people, how they are as a person, to be honest, man.
I feel like sometimes with the music, if the person move funny and I don't really, I can't listen to the music no more.
I
totally understand. Yeah, man. 2022. How you liking the state of state of hip hop right now, man? We in a good space.
I feel like we are, man. Mm-hmm. There's been so much, dope music coming out over these last couple of years. Honestly, since the pandemic started, to be honest, man. Like, especially in the underground, it's been a I've discovered a lot of new artists that I didn't know anything about, and they all been pretty dope. I feel like it's in a great space, great spot right now.
Yeah, I do too, and you're definitely, a part of that, man. And it's interesting because a lot of times I think, people will complain about where we are musically, because of, you know, the same things that they see on the major networks or things like that. But if you just take the time to look, man, there's a lot of great MCs out there.
Most of the old arguments I hear is they're talking about mainstream.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Most of the time. And I'm like, bro, like, we got plenty of any type of music you're looking for, honestly, like, it's out here. Mm-hmm. You just gotta, like you said, you just gotta look or listen. Like, find it, man. It's out here.
Yeah, it is. It is. And you're right. And you just gotta look for it. As far as musically, I know at one time, you know, you know, as an artist, you know, we talked about the good parts of the game, getting the love and you know, the recognition from your peers. But do you ever get like, yeah, man, I'm tired of this shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, or just everything that come with it, man. You know, you ever feel like that?
Yeah, I feel like that recently, man. I feel like that often, to be honest, man. But I that's creating music is one of my biggest outlets.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I'm never gonna completely, you know, disregard it or step away from it. But at times, I do feel like, you know, I don't feel like trying to be creative for other people. You know what I mean? When I create music anyway, I make it for myself. But as far as putting it out, it's like sometimes I just feel like, man, I'm making this for me to listen to. Like, I don't want to put it out. I don't care about getting feedback from somebody or whatever, man. I'm just doing it for me. But I feel like that a lot, man. Yeah.
You know, at your age, we'll let you quit though.
Yeah, man, I'm trying, man. I mean, you know, I know the one time I said something about it, I tweeted it, whatever, man. And mad people was like, nah, man, I'm like, yo, man, you gotta be in my shoes, man, to understand like why I feel the way I feel. But
if you can, without giving too much, because honestly, I understand how certain things may be personal. But where does that come from? You know, that feeling of, you know, just like, well, no, okay, I'll reword that. Like you said, you know, the fans aren't in your shoes, right? All they do is see the finished product. But what are some things, or, you know, that can get you mentally there where you're like, yo, I just don't have the energy to release this right now, or I don't have the, or I don't want to release this right now. Like, you know, let everybody walk in your shoes just for a minute, just and kind of take us through that.
Most of the time it's just like, you know, life stuff, like real life stuff that I'm dealing with or whatever, and I just don't be thinking about the music as much.
Yeah.
But like I said, it's an outlet, so I come back to it anyway. Mm-hmm. And then the response that it may or may not get sometimes, like that'll do it sometimes, man. And it don't really be as bad as I make it. I'll make an excuse, basically, man, just to be like, all right, I'm done. I'm chilling for a while, like, yeah. So, in a nutshell, that's pretty much it, man.
I understand. You know, a lot of artists, even not just musical artists, painters, people that draw, like, a lot of times they feel the same way, you know what I'm saying, where it's like they'll go through a spell where, but then they get right back to it, you know what I'm saying? Because it's something that they love to do. When it comes to music, like, who are some of your musical inspiration?
Well, of course, we talked about Ransom, man. He's one. I love Lupe, man. Blue, Elzai. Those guys are on my Pinspiration list. Like I call it my pinspiration list. Like I can certain stuff they, you know, I listen to from them. I can it'll inspire my pen to move just off hearing them, you know, whatever. And Ransom, he sent me a lot of unreleased stuff that, you know, he's working on. So that happens often with him, more often than with the other ones. But those like the main ones.
Yeah, like whenever you hear them, like it just kind of motivates you to pick up your pen.
Yeah. Even if it's you know, just one or two lines, like just something, just hearing them say a certain things, like like, you know, but those like the main four.
No doubt. What you working on now, or is, what can everybody expect moving forward this year?
So I got Ignorant Art that's going to be dropping, produced by A.O. Shamir. It's me and Fabian, super dope artist out of Massachusetts. And I got Vanity Stain 2 with A.O. Shamir and Greenery. They producing that joint. I'm thinking about doing another EP. Got some singles and stuff that's gonna be dropping, some features coming out soon. I'm thinking about doing another EP. I don't necessarily know what direction I'm gonna go in with it. Mm-hmm. But I try not to make the same project over and over because I hear that a lot.
I do too.
So
I think that so could be trying not to make a issue sometimes with artists that release a lot of music is not to make the same album over and over. That's something that you're pretty conscious of, huh?
Yeah, man. I try not to, man. Like the guy mentioned Solstice, like that don't sound like any other EP or project I have, man. It was all like soulful, hard drum beats, like, and there's even the songs, man. So, yeah, like I try to be mindful of that when I do put something together. I think the Hoop Dreams 2, it sounds nothing like the first one.
Right.
Yeah, like I keep all that stuff in mind, man. When I get ready to put a project together,
no doubt.
But other than I think that's pretty much it for this year. I might do another full length, because Vanity Stain 2 and Ignorant Art are full length.
Okay,
I might do a third one, and probably a 4 or 5 track EP. Another 4 or 5 track EP.
All right, that's a lot of work, man. That's a lot of work. You know, that'll definitely satisfy the people. You mentioned. Yeah. Hey, yo, Shamir, I had him on the show as well. Dope producer. How'd y'all link up?
Super dope, man. Actually, through Fabian, man. So Broken Easel, the track Nothing. I think it's the third track on there with Fabian. That was Fabian's song when he hit me for the feature on that. Mm-hmm. And I was like, who made this beat or whatever? Mm-hmm. He was like, you know, hey, yo, Shamir. And when I was putting the tape together, like we had linked or whatever, so he was kind of hands on with helping me put it together, and he produced like majority of that project, and I just ended up asking Fave, like, could I have that song for the tape? He was like, yeah, we'll get some more in. Like I'm like, bet. So. Cause it fit, you know. So, like Shamir had most of the production. I think like 7 songs on the tape. Greeny had a few, but that's how we met, man, through Fabian.
Yeah, that's dope, man. That's dope. Well, JR, man, I definitely appreciate you. We finally made it happen, man.
Yeah.
But I definitely appreciate you for coming through, man. I'm a big fan of your work. And you know, just keep dropping that heat that everybody love, man. If for people that haven't tapped in yet, how can they find you on social media, and how can they find your music?
Yeah, so on Twitter is J_DOT_ARRR. It's three R's. IG real_J_ARRR. That's pretty much all I'm on as far as social media goes. My music, you can just pretty much type it in on whatever DSP. Mm-hmm. J_ARRR, I'll pop up. Should be the first, should be the only one to pop up, honestly. That's pretty much all my links or whatever.
I said no doubt, man. I extremely appreciate you, man, and I ain't gonna hold you too long, man. You have a good rest of your day, bro, and man, you know, we'll definitely link up again.
Yeah, for sure, man. Appreciate you having me, man.
No doubt.
Appreciate
man.
The support too.
Oh yeah, always, bro.
Yeah, man.